Welcome, dear class and Mrs. Cool. Today I'm gonna represent you my topic, England in the late Victorian era. I will represent you my topics about inventions,
religions,
and
Jack the Ripper.
So have fun with the presentation.
Two.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Let's go together, God save me that road show down rap paradise. Let's go together.
Let's go to number one. Important inventions. We all make it, we all use it. Pictures are today unthinkable without. But when did the first real made picture with a camera happen? The first ever made camera was invented by Niespor Nietzsche, and later on it was perfected by Louis Daguerre. Because of him, the first prototype camera was named by him the Daguerre type camera. It was a huge wooden box, it took advantage of the sensitivity of silver salts to light and produced photographs on silver coated plates. Added to this was the world's first photographic lens developed by Charles Chevalier. Its achromatic design would eventually become the inspiration for our lens. Chevalier's lens was combined with the Daguerre type camera, and together they initiated a successful change in the history of photography. In 1826, Joseph Niespor Nietzsche succeeded in taking the first permanent picture. For this, he exposed a tin plate coated with asphalt for unbelievable 8 hours. Nietzsche chose an obvious motive, the view from his office in Saint-Loup-de-Varennes, France.
Magic.
As much as the technology develops, so does the war. During the 19th century, the British Empire continued to grow, fall at a cost, and there's not one decade of victorious regime that did not see some form of conflict in the empire. During Queen Victoria's time on the throne, British and Imperial soldiers faced battle across India, Africa, Southeast Asia, and Eastern Europe. Here we examine the South African War, one of the most famous conflicts of the era, which continued to resonate whether for their privileges or political implications. In 1877, tensions arose between the Boers and the British after the British annexed the Transvaal, and war broke out in December 1818. The fighting was short-lived and the Boers won victory and partial independence in March, although they remained under British suzerainty. In 1899, relations deteriorated again after gold was discovered in the region. A long bloodier war ensued, which the Boers fought as guerrilla warfare for the last 2 years. The British responded by rounding up Boer women and children in camps, where many starved to death, and using scorched earth tactics. The Boer territory was deliberately and systematically devastated to deprive the guerrilla fighters of food and shelter. The Boers eventually complied. The subsequent treaty ended Boer independence. At the beginning of the Victorian era, slavery was abolished in the British Empire. While slavery was abolished in the British Empire on the 1st August 1833, only children under the age of 6 were freed immediately under the terms of the 1833 Emancipation Act. All other former slaves were bound as apprentices, where they continued to work without pay for their former owners. When the apprenticeship period ended in 1838, over 700,000 slaves were freed in the British Caribbean. Plantation owners received nearly £20 million in government compensation for the loss of their slaves, but unfortunately the former slaves received nothing. Number 2. Religions. Most of the people who lived in the Victorian era were Christians, but there were some religious diversity, as Britain was also home to another non-Victorians, such as Roman Catholics, Jews, Muslims, Hindus, and others. At first, it might sound strange that women's rights are related to religions, but it is. The Christian played a big role because Christianity was such a huge part of life and because the church had so much power over the people. Religious teachings and ideas were seen into literature. Thomas Cranmer wrote the Common Book of Prayer. The Book of Common Prayer, although nearly completely forgotten in contemporary English religion, was very crucial during this era. The Bible was translated into a prayer book, which was then revised into the Book of Common Prayer and used by Christians. The Women's Christian Temperance Union was a Christian women's organization founded at this time. It was based on evangelical Christianity and pursued women's political goals in addition to the prohibition of alcohol. These different groups offered women a way to be involved in society despite their lower social status. They also increased the influence of the different Christian denominations at this time. An incredibly well-known religious charity also emerged during this time, the Salvation Army. The Salvation Army, which today has more than 1.6 million members, focused on missionary and charity work in London's East End, serving those who were rejected by both society and the church. Talking about religions in the Victorian era, we also have, maybe the upper side of religions, the occultism. Occultism, various theories and practices involving belief in this knowledge or use of supernatural power or beings. Such beliefs and practices, essentially magical or divinatory, have existed in all human societies throughout history, with considerable variation both in their nature and in societies' attitudes towards them. However, before the term occultism was even naturalized in Britain, it was called spiritualism. This was so popular in the mid-19th century that the practices even found followers in the higher circles. Madame von der Meyer, for example, was a convinced spiritualist and close friend of Queen Victoria. A medium is a person who claims to receive messages from supernatural beings such as angels and spirits, or to have other kinds of non-physical perceptions. It is not scientifically verifiable that such people really exist. The Queen's favorite servant is even said to have been a medium. Through him, she is said to have tried to establish a connection with her later husband Prince Albert in order to be able to communicate with him. Interesting to know that in the Victorian era the most people were Christians, but the Bible says that some angels rebelled against God and made themselves his enemies. Folk spiritualism once supposed these evil angels in their rebellion against God. Demons wants to deliberately deceive people, for example, for spirit, mediums, or fortune tellers. Such persons are on one side with God's enemies. Final part. Jack the Ripper. Famous in many movies and fan fictions, Jack the Ripper is truly a notorious killer. London, 1888. At the evening on the Whitechapel Street, a notorious killer was on his way and killed five women. The official police department registered 11 official victims murdered from Jack the Ripper. At first, he just sounds like a normal crazy murderer who killed five women, but there's of course more. Jack the Ripper got his notorious name Ripper because every woman he killed, he mutilated her bodies and removed her organs. Only very few murders would act in such a targeted manner. Maybe we should look at the official information about one of the victims from Jack the Ripper. Let's look at Annie Chapman. Many people assume that Jack the Ripper only killed prostitute women, but this is not true. Annie Chapman was a normal woman who had a normal marriage. She worked as a lifeguard in the 2nd Regiment. The police officers tried to find a connection between the victims, but unfortunately, none of the victims knew each other or ever saw each other. The victims had no connections. But they did find something about Jack the Ripper himself. He was probably a former doctor who was an ordinary citizen who belongs to the upper class. This does not sound like a murder, but it would explain why Jack the Ripper was able to selectively remove the organs of his victims. If these are not enough reasons why Jack the Ripper is so notorious, it is perhaps important to mention that unlike the other murderers, he was never caught. Until this day, no one knows the true identity of Jack the Ripper.
Hello?
I need to speak to my wife. So could you get her on the phone, please?
Oh, okay. Alright. Have you slept with someone else again, Arnie?
No! I mean, no, that's fine. On your way out, just tell her we'll be a few minutes late, but you shouldn't worry.
Oh my god, these cookies taste so good from your wife, man!
Put that cookie down! Now!